Good afternoon. Would you please rise and welcome the members of the Board of Selectmen, the School Committee, Superintendent Neef, Carver Middle High School Administration, faculty and staff, and of course, the graduating class of 2016.
Thank you. Good afternoon. As the superintendent of the Carver Public Schools, I'm proud to welcome the community of Carver on this fourth day of June to celebrate the class of 2016. Please welcome the Carver Fire Department Color Guard for the presentation of the colors. At this time, if we could please remain standing to honor our nation as Megan Cullity, Nadia Golubov, Paul Butts, and Justin Schindler sing the national anthem. Please welcome the Vice President of the Class of 2016, Bridget O'Connor, who will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good afternoon. Before I have the privilege of briefly addressing the class, I'd like to acknowledge and thank the people whose work has been essential to the success of those who are seated on the stage today. First, parents and guardians. Thank you for your devotion to your children and their futures. In today's ceremony, we will recognize and thank many people. It makes sense that you would be the first. You are ultimately and primarily responsible for molding and shaping the students we see before us on the stage today. Many of you are looking at partial reflections of yourselves. Your effort and hard work have played the instrumental role in the success of your children. You should rightfully take great pride in their accomplishments. To the Carver Middle High School faculty and staff, this has been a bittersweet year for me. I'm excited about and have enjoyed my new role as superintendent of the Carver Public Schools. But it's been a difficult transition in one respect. I no longer have the opportunity to work with you on a daily basis. I miss that aspect of being the principal of Carver Middle High School. I truly appreciate all you do for the students of the school. The most important component of any school is the teacher in the classroom. Our students rise to the expectations that are set for them. And on a daily basis in your classrooms, it is you that provides our students with tremendous opportunities to learn, to grow, and to think. Thank you for your dedication to our students. You as well should take great pride in their accomplishments. Mr. Souza, thank you for your outstanding work in your first year as the assistant principal at Carver High School. Your effective communication with students and parents provides everyone with a clear understanding of their responsibilities. You have a great understanding of the big picture, and I've enjoyed working with you tremendously. You've done a fine job in your first year and should be commended. Mrs. Bertram, Mrs. Kilnap, Mr. Rhoda, as senior class advisors, thank you for the work that you take on to ensure that all our senior activities have been fun, meaningful, and memorable. You've done an outstanding job, and you've shown outstanding leadership. You're always calm under pressure, like when the bus didn't show up to take us to the airport for grad bash. You're always thinking about what we can do to make this the best possible senior year ever. The amount of time and effort that you put into this position is tremendous. You've clearly proven yourself to be dedicated to these students and our school. Thank you. Thank you to Mr. Tunis and the Carver High School Band for your time and effort in providing all of the music during our graduation week ceremonies. Thank you to all of our administrative assistants, Ms. Rush, Mrs. Calderoni, Ms. Gould, also to Mr. Siedentoff and all the custodians, and the staff and crew of Area 58 for all the work that you do behind the scenes to make this a perfect day. Thank you to Ms. Hiller for her years of dedication to the students of Carver Middle High School and her annual decoration of the foyer for graduation. And finally, to the Carver community, thank you for your continued investment in our school. Today, we celebrate the fruits of your investment. Through the generosity of many people, our graduates have been awarded over $57,000 in scholarships donated from alumni, business, community, and memorial organizations. Alumni scholarships from the Carver High School classes of 2001, 2006, 2011, and the Plymouth Carver High School class of 1966. Scholarships in memory of Alfred W. Closet, Gordon Barrows, Pauline Catino, Elizabeth Cushman, Arthur F. Orenberger, Nancy Tucker, Doreen Merritt, Jake Town, Midge Roby, Daniel Labassiere, Thomas P. Coyne, Zach Kane, and Daria Amaral. The Carver Lions Club donated scholarships in memory of their members, William Kingsbury, William Zeiser, Crosby Bing Hurd, and Charles Brad Richards. Local businesses and financial institutions were also generous in their support with scholarships from the Harbor Insurance Agency, AD Makepeace, Mutual Savings Bank, Honeydew Donuts, Dimension Design and Wellness Studio, Deacus Cranberry, the Family Driving School, the Area 58 Cable Community Access Media. Community and civic organizations also donated to our seniors, including Carver Pop Warner, the Carver Volunteer Firefighters, the Carver Police Union and Good Citizenship Scholarship, the Julian Southworth American Legion, the South Meadow Village Association, the Carver Sportsman's Club, the Massachusetts Veterans Services, the residents of Newfield House, St. John the Baptist, Box Tops for Education, Carver Old Home Day, Thomas O. and Sarah Jackson Community Foundation, and the Wareham Police Association. School organizations donated scholarships including the Carver Middle High School staff, the Carver Elementary staff, Carver Elementary PTO, the Rocky Gomes Scholar Athlete Scholarship, the Candace Weiler Scholarship, the Carver Middle High School PTO, the Carver Middle High School National Honor Society, the Educational Association of Plymouth and Carver, the Carver Music Boosters, the Odyssey in the Mind and Destination Imagination Scholarship, the Carver Crusader Corner School Store, the Carver Pop Warner, the Carver Athletic Boosters, and Carver Girls Softball. Can we please have a round of applause for all of our generous scholarship donors? To the class of 2016, your class entered the sixth grade in the fall of 2009, which was my first full year as principal of the combined Carver Middle High School. One of the true gifts and special memories that I will have about this class is that I've had the opportunity to watch you grow and mature, from sixth graders to graduating seniors. You will be the only class in which I served your principal, well, almost, I did leave on March 1st, throughout your entire middle high school experience. What I value about the most about this experience is I've had the opportunity to work with, to get to know each and every one of you. I see you on the stage today as adults, but in my mind's eyes, I can picture you all as sixth graders. As I reflected on your 7 years at Carver Middle High School, all I can think about is how hard you've worked and how much you've achieved. On a regular basis, I'm humbled by what you've accomplished as a class and as individuals. You've always demonstrated a wide range of talents and abilities in academics, athletics, and the arts. I've been impressed watching you perform in the classroom, on our fields and courts, on this stage. And just by your kindness, represented by how you interact with each other and the faculty and the staff. You've all demonstrated you've met the school's 21st century learning expectations of being effective readers, writing with clarity and purpose, presenting with clarity and purpose, collaborating effectively, and using information ethically and critically. You have been prepared by your family, by your teachers, by our coaches, by our community, by this school, with a set of skills that have empowered you as learners, but much more importantly, as people. Ralph Waldo Emerson said, "What lies behind us and what lies before us are tiny matters compared to what lies within us." What lies within you, the class of 2016? I think I know a little. Courage, character, love, a spirit of charity, a dedication to friends and family, a set of skills. I've said to each and every person on this stage, empowered learners can do anything. I believe today's ceremony is the affirmation, the final seal, that you are all empowered learners and that you can all do anything. In my 23 years of work at Carver Middle High School, it's evident to me that life has become more complex and challenging. The demands we have and do place on our students as individuals is always increasing. From the pressure to take as many AP courses as possible, to the expectation that you play each of your sports year-round from a very young age, to your active involvement in music and dance and drama, it seems everything in our lives has become organized and structured. And to what end? Vicki Abels and Jessica Condon call this the race to nowhere in a documentary film of the same name. As impressed as I am by all that you do and all that you accomplished, sometimes I worry about you. Are you truly happy? I'm not sure happiness always drives your decisions. I'm not sure that happiness always drives all of our decisions. We've always been taught, and what our society espouses, is deferred gratification. Work hard today, and success and happiness will follow. In his book, The Happiness Advantage by Sean Aker, he argues the opposite. Do what makes you happy. Work hard and success will follow. It's happiness that fuels you. People are not happy because they are successful. They reach the highest level of success because they're happy. What motivated Aker's work was his life as a student and professor and academic advisor at Harvard University. In Paradise Lost, John Milton said, "The mind is its own place, and in itself can make a heaven of hell a hell of heaven." Aker was amazed by the number of Harvard students that he worked with who were stressed, depressed, unable to cope. He asked himself, how can this be? They've made it. They're at Harvard. They'll have countless opportunities available to them upon graduation. How can there be so many unhappy people at this school? At the same time, he began to work with and research with a group of Harvard psychology professors who were looking at positive psychology. And what their research determined is that being happy is the best predictor of performance and success. So my advice to you as graduates, as adults, is make sure we do things that make you happy. Now, that doesn't mean don't go to college and travel the world. It doesn't mean just hang out with your friends in the basement. What it does mean is you should examine what you're doing in life and make sure you build in time to do something that makes you smile, do something you enjoy, because ultimately this will increase your ability to be successful. It will allow you to reach your maximum potential. A psychologist, Martin Siegelman, who worked with Aker at Harvard, broke happiness into three measurable components: pleasure, engagement, and meaning. People who only seek pleasure without engagement or meaning generally aren't really happy. Acre defines happiness as the joy we feel striving after our potential. But my question to all of you is, what makes you happy? I want you to really think about that. And for everyone in this auditorium, it's probably something completely different. It could be athletics or working out. It could be spending time with friends and family. It could be reading or spending time alone. It could be painting or playing the guitar. It could be volunteering or helping a friend. It could be you fill in the blank. My challenge to all of you is, make sure you take time and advantage of the opportunities that come along to do things that make you happy. You often hear people say, I don't have time for that. But that's ultimately a cop-out. You make your own time. You decide how you're going to spend your time and what you're going to spend your time on. In his book, Acre outlines several principles that fuel happiness and success, including having a positive mindset, being able to imagine the possibility, what he calls falling up, and social investment. A positive mindset. Our minds are limited resources. We can't waste our brain power on negativity and uncertainty. Acre argues that it is the mental construct of our activities, not the activities themselves, that defines our reality. Meaning your mindset as you complete activities is sometimes more important than what you do. Having a positive mindset is the foundation of happiness. Imagine the possibility. As you evaluate where you currently are, you should always imagine what's possible. Imagine what your life, your job, your relationships could and or should be. The most famous representation of the concept of imagining the possibility, in my opinion, is Dr. Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech. Dr. King imagined the possibility of what he wanted the world to look like one day, a day we're moving ever closer to. On the steps of the Lincoln Memorial in 1963, Dr. King said, I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that my four children will one day live in a nation where they not be judged by the color of the skin, but by the content of their character. As you sit on the stage today, imagine the possibilities of your future. The possibilities of your class is innumerable. I hope that I'm still here in 30 or 50 years to see what you've accomplished. Falling up. As kids, we've all learned to ride a bike. And the reality is that everyone who learned to ride a bike fell off that bike. And what did we all do? We got back up on it. Because that's what you have to do. You have to get back on the bike. As Thomas Edison said, I have not failed. I've just found 10,000 ways that don't work. That is the epitome of falling up. Happy people demonstrate resiliency. They achieve not despite their setbacks, but because of them. And finally, social investment. No one achieves happiness or success alone. It is the result of the support of many. Build strong alliances. All of us are ultimately responsible for the direction our lives take, but none of us could be on the stage today without the help and the support of others. The people with the strongest social networks are often the most successful. Many of you have already begun to build your social networks. I encourage you to maintain and strengthen the alliances you already have, but also always seek to build new ones. This will help you as you strive to achieve your personal goals. So as you go forward from this day, think about what makes you happy. As you get older, what gives you pleasure will evolve. Make sure you never stop asking yourself the question, what makes me happy? And make sure you make choices with your time to do those things. Maybe that means going for a walk on a beautiful day. Maybe it means frequently traveling. Maybe it means narrowing the range of activities you're involved in. Maybe it means taking on new challenges. Maybe it means spending time laughing with your friends and family. So to the class of 2016, live your life being optimistic. Imagine the possibilities. Practice falling up. And build strong social networks. Remember, happiness is the greatest predictor of success, not the other way around. Use the happiness advantage to reach your pinnacle. So for one last time, I take the pleasure in being able to say, it is with pride that I served as your principal. Thank you. Best of luck in the future, and congratulations to each and every one of you. This year, we're bringing a new tradition into our graduation ceremony. We decided to do a student competition for the speech, for one of our speeches at graduation. We presented this to the class in January, and we said, if anybody would like to give a speech at graduation, we want you to submit that speech to Mrs. Kilnap, and we'll have it reviewed by a group of teachers, and then we'll pick a few people to present their speech to a group of teachers, and then we'll select what we believe to be the strongest of the group to present at graduation. So several students did turn in speeches. We reviewed them. We selected the top two of those speeches. We had them present to a panel of teachers. And then from that, we selected Ashley Bossy as our student winner of our speech competition for graduation. So at this time, please welcome Ashley Bossy to address her classmates.
Nervous. Not too long ago, I was babysitting my three-year-old cousin, Julia. As she was watching her favorite movie, Frozen, she looked over to find me working on my calculus homework. Confused whatever could be more important than singing Let It Go with her, she came over and asked me what I was doing. I explained to her that I was working on homework for school. To this, she responded, "What's school?" "Well, Julia, that's where I go every day, kind of like how you go to daycare." "Oh, so you go to school because your mommy and daddy are at work." "Well, yes, but I also go so I can be smart and learn things and get a job like mommy and daddy." She then asked me what I learn at school. Trying to explain to a three-year-old what you're learning in your senior classes is surprisingly difficult. Julia doesn't know what calculus is. She doesn't even know what it means to write a paragraph. So I tried to explain to her in a way that she would understand. And I told her that I learn about numbers and letters. I thought that was an adequate explanation, something simple that she could understand. To this, she responded, "Oh, Ashy, I already know my numbers and letters." And she proceeded to count to 10 while skipping the number 7. The reason I tell you this little anecdote is because every conversation I have with Julia makes me think especially hard about the world around me. She's so young and innocent and impressionable, I don't want to tell her the wrong thing. This conversation in particular made me think about what I've been spending the last 12 plus years of my life doing. Why we go to school? Why is graduating so important? Through this self-reflection, I realized that while in school, I have learned things that I will use every day for the rest of my life, like addition, subtraction, how to read, how to write. I also realized that I have learned things that I will most likely never use again, like how to play the recorder, or how to find the exact time that two trains going at different speeds will crash into each other. And after a lot of thought, I came to the conclusion that the most important things I have learned while in school were not in my teacher's lesson plans. They were the underlying truths that I and we of a class have learned through our experiences with our teachers, friends, classmates, and family. From Mrs. Booth, I have learned how a friendly smile in the hallway can change someone's day. Mrs. Perkins has taught me that it's okay if not everyone likes or agrees with what I have to say. Mrs. Ryan has taught me to never give anything less than my best effort. And Ms. Littleton has helped me to focus on the positive things in life rather than stress about the negatives. Mr. Lyman encourages me to question the world around me. And Mr. Davies taught me to take a break and look at the stars. Mrs. Kilnap encourages my creativity like no one else can. And Mr. Tunis has taught me that failure is not when you mess up, it's when you're not passionate about what you're doing. Mrs. Markram has taught me to take a second look at things because there's always room for improvement. Mrs. Waitner has always pushed me to be a better version of myself in all aspects of my life. And from Mrs. Young, I have learned that one bad grade does not diminish what I've already accomplished in a class. Chelsea Dion has shown me the value of being truly authentic. And Megan Burnell has taught me how to be a true friend. I've learned to laugh at myself from Rebecca Scheifele and Mary Plant. And Monica Walsack inspires me to stay true to my morals. Cassie Whitford taught me not to care what other people think of me. Kaylee, Tess, Bree, and Dahl, in you I see a friendship that will last forever, and I admire that. I admire Imani Niev's strength and persistence. From Allison Tugas, I have learned to give it all on your dance floor and have a good time. And from Crystal Neal, she has shown me that even though as we grow older, there's still time to be silly. Tanisha Pyrez's positivity inspires me. And Justin Abria has taught me to never let anything hold you back. From Erin Alexander, I have learned the power of laughter. And from a foreign exchange student who visited our school this year, Victoria Burtonchamps, she has taught me that as I go to college next year, I cannot be afraid to step out of my comfort zone. My parents have given me the unconditional love that I needed. My brother Chris has shown me that hard work does pay off. My grandparents have instilled in me the importance of family, and my aunt and uncle have always supported me. And I know my bupshi is always watching over me. And from little Julia, I have learned that you're never too young to make the world a better place. I've learned each of these lessons from the people in this very auditorium. These everyday virtues cannot be taught from a textbook. They must be experienced. To my fellow members of the class of 2016, whether you are continuing on with your education, serving our country, or joining the workforce, I urge you to continue learning from the people around you. I have learned something from each and every one of you, and I am forever grateful for that. Thank you to all the amazing staff and faculty at Carver Mill High School who have helped to inspire my appreciation for learning. And most importantly, thank you to my family who have given me the love and support that I need to follow my dreams. Congratulations to the class of 2016. We did it!
Now I have the honor and the pleasure of recognizing our salutatorian and valedictorians for the class of 2016, who are both going to address the audience and their classmates. Our salutatorian for the class of 2016, Ari Rosen.
I've been waiting for this moment since sixth grade. There are many reasons I have the opportunity to address you today. First, I'd like to thank my parents and my family and my sister for being incredibly supportive of me throughout high school. I really wouldn't be here without you guys. I'd also like to thank all the teachers and administrators and faculty at Carver for dedicating their careers to our education and to our success. And thank you all for being here to celebrate with us today. Additionally, I just wanted to take a second to congratulate and thank Carly Ryan. Carly, I want to thank you for setting the pace. I've always felt that I've been one step behind you since we are lab partners in freshman physics class. Like I've been running in your footsteps. I have a tremendous amount of respect and admiration for your intelligence and your way of thinking and how you never cease to bring something new to the table. As runners, we both know that you don't know how fast you can go until you're trying to keep up with the pace setter. And I don't think I would have pushed myself as hard as I did if I hadn't been trying to keep up with the pace you set. So thank you and congratulations for everything you've achieved. I know you'll find success wherever you go in the future. Just when it seemed like we would never make it back to the main trail, my family and I caught a glimpse of a small bike path that would lead to the main one. I breathed a sigh of relief, picturing myself sitting safely in the AC'd minivan within minutes. We were about to reach this path when suddenly, right at my toes, an unmistakable rattle came from the bush immediately in front of me. It shattered our anxious silence and sent my dad and sister sprinting away. This is a moment that will always be vivid in my mind, but you don't know what I'm talking about yet, so let me take a step back. After freshman year, while in Arizona on vacation with my family, we decided to go on a hike in Sedona. As you may know, Arizona has a thriving population of rattlesnakes. It just so happens that I have a strong fear of snakes. So in the days leading up to our hike, I felt some anxiety about it. In fact, I had a recurring nightmare that we would run into a snake, one of us would get bitten. It made me really nervous. So on the day of the hike, I went along with the uneasy feeling that one of these nightmares might come into fruition. Upon arrival, however, I was greatly relieved to see that the hiking trails were wide, fully sunned, and frequently traveled, the least ideal place for a snake. There was no chance a rattler would be hanging out on one of these trails. So we continued on our hike until we got to a large climbing rock formation. We climbed it, and on the way back down, my dad, being the adventurous and curious man he is, suggested that we take a different route back to the car. Not the normal hiking trail, but on a self-proclaimed shortcut he was sure he could see on the other side of the climbing rock. Robert Frost said, two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and I took the one less traveled. Well, my dad said, I didn't take either. I cut straight through the woods. So I followed him apprehensively, not wanting to go along with it, but also not wanting to get split up. Before I knew it, I was jumping over bushes from clearing to clearing in the middle of the Arizona desert without a trail in sight. Now keep in mind my initial fear of rattlesnakes. With every rustle of the bush, I imagined that a snake would jump out at me, latch its fangs onto my ankle, and I would die from the venom before we could even make it back to the car. For about 20 minutes, my dad and my sister tore through the terrain as I anxiously scanned every inch before making my next move. Just when it seemed like we would never make it back to the car, we glimpsed a small bike path that would lead to the main one. I breathed a sigh of relief, picturing myself sitting safely within the AC'd minivan within minutes. We were about to reach this path when suddenly, right at my toes, an unmistakable rattle came from the bush immediately in front of me. It shattered our anxious silence and sent my dad and sister sprinting away. I froze and burst into tears, and my mom stopped behind me. I didn't want to take another step in fear that there was a rattlesnake under every bush that lay ahead. I said I didn't want to continue. I said I would not walk any further. I continued sobbing until my mom grabbed me at the shoulders. She shook me and said, Ari, you need to get a hold of yourself. The idea of moving in any direction went against every rational bone in my body. But I also knew that I couldn't stay there. So it took me a little while, but I stopped crying, pulled myself together, and we pressed on to eventually make it back to the main path and to our car. I could blame my dad for taking us off the trail that day and literally making my nightmares come true. Or I could thank him. I could thank him because he forced me out of my comfort zone. My comfort zone that day was on the wide, sunny, crowded trails. By stepping off of them, I learned that no matter how afraid you are to take your next step, you have to keep pushing forward because there is no turning back. Oh, sorry, cap's falling off. It wasn't until this speech that I realized how thankful I am for being pushed by my father to do something that made me uncomfortable. It's the flip in perspective that makes all the difference. I learned to be thankful for the terrifying experience I had that day, to be thankful for not missing out on encountering a wild rattlesnake in the heart of Arizona. For that, I have gratitude to my adventurous family who forced me out of my comfort zone. Maybe the lesson is to accept the challenge of going out of your comfort zone so that you can change your perspective. People say that the only way to grow is to step out of our comfort zones. You get comfortable outside of it, and then your comfort zone expands. You step out of it again, and each time you grow a little bit. You gain strength, you gain knowledge, You gain experience each time that helps you deal with the next challenge. Sometimes these steps can be exciting, an exciting adventure, but other times they're so terrifying they seem nearly impossible to take. What would have happened if Odysseus didn't accept the call to fight in the Trojan War? I'm sorry, I love Odysseus. I couldn't omit him from my speech. He would have stayed in Ithaca, raised his son, and remained the same prideful man he had always been. But he accepted the call, and for that, he fought a cyclops, he went down into the underworld and came back, and he conquered his pride to accept humility. He recognizes his personal growth is the reason that the 10 years he spends at sea are not wasted. It's the perspective he returns with that makes him epic. The lesson is to adjust your perspective. Stepping out of your comfort zone and changing your perspective go hand in hand. If I've learned anything from my run-in with the rattlesnake, it's that the only way to move forward is by changing your old way of thinking and accepting a new one. If I can't accept my encounter with the snake as a lesson, then I'm wasting it. Today, we stand on the precipice of our future. Take the 4 years we have spent in high school and look at it as one perspective. For the past 13 years, we have had a place to be every day. We have had structure, guidance, instruction. We have relied on the sound of a bell to tell us when it's time to move. When we flip our tassels from the right to the left, we will be leaving the comfort zone that has been this school since the sixth grade. I hope that you will all take this opportunity to seek a new perspective as we are being pushed out of our comfort zone, to allow your comfort zones to be challenged. We all want to stay on our wide, sunny trails because they're safe and they're comfortable, and it's never easy to have your comfort zones challenged. Sure, there are some things that are frightening about stepping off the trail, like facing failure, vulnerability, or rattlesnakes. But if we never step off, we will miss out on the opportunity to gain new perspectives. So don't run from whatever rattlesnakes you encounter in the future. Face them head on, accept their duality, allow yourself to grow, and be thankful for the people that challenge you to do so. Thank you.
As a point of comparison, so Ari was the salutatorian this year. If we compared her to any of our previous valedictorians, Ari would have been the valedictorian of the class of 2016. She had the second highest GPA in the history of Carver Middle High School. But as she stated in the beginning of her speech, she had a pace setter, who is Kali Ryan, who happened to have the highest GPA in the history of Carver Middle High School. So if we could please rise and acknowledge the valedictorian of the class of 2016 as she addresses her classmates, Kali Ryan.
Cannon to the right of them, cannon to the left of them, cannon behind them. Volleyed and thundered, stormed out with shot and shell, while horse and hero fell. They that had fought so well came through the jaws of death, back from the mouth of hell. All that was left of them, left of 100. Congratulations, class of 2016, we survived the jaws of Carver High. Together, we've dodged the bullets shot at us from tardy sweeps, no Wi-Fi because of park testing, and the infamous parking stickers. We have flown under the watchful eye of Mr. Rooney in the hallways and snuck in and out of every door, especially when Moe's offered free t-shirts. Each pep rally was a success, and here we stand as four-time champions. and Carver Athletics was victorious under our command. Our soccer teams made it to state tournaments and took home league championships. Our football team rose up for two winning seasons. The cross-country team snagged a winning title. Softball and tennis marched their way to postseason tournaments. Our track leads showed strong at states and also took home league titles. Our musicians let their cadence ring, attending Grady's Music Festival and bringing home high gold each year, and a consistent group rose the ranks to perform at SEMSBA. Our artists showed their colors through Ms. McKenna's office, the hoop house, and hallway murals. Not every win was so easy. I remember the struggle to keep my head above the water as the onslaught of Mr. A's homework, Mrs. Dean's projects, Mr. Lamro's study guides, and Ms. Perkins' essays piled up. At times, it felt like we were constantly under siege from home issues, social problems, and schoolwork. When morale was low, music provided me with encouraging words. Wally told me to be well-connected, well-respected, and well-protected. Schoolboy Q said, read a book, exercise, and keep your spirit in. And Eminem asked me, if you had one shot or one opportunity to see everything you've ever wanted in one moment, would you capture it or would you just let it slip? And every single person on this stage captured it. People love to tell us that high school will fly by in a blink of an eye. So when it was 4 a.m. and I was bent over my textbook, I'd squeeze my eyes tight, real shut, and I'd hope to open them to this moment, graduation. That moment is here today. We graduate as a class, and it took everyone's support to achieve it. Thank you, Quizlet, for having pre-made practice problems and flashcards to get me through late-minute studying. Thank you, friends, that could send screenshots of the worksheets I misplaced, even if it was 3 a.m. Thank you, teachers, who understood that we are not machines, and if you have a Stucco meeting, robotics, NHS induction, and soccer game all in one night, you might need an extension on that homework. Thank you, guidance counselors, for always providing an ear to listen to our complaints. Thank you, God, for giving me the strength and will to make it through each day, whether it was a big exam like SATs or the last 100 meters of my track race, I would repeat in my head, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Thank you, parents and relatives, for supporting us through our education. Personally, I'd like to thank my dad for keeping your standards high and keeping me on track. Mom, you're the best secretary I'll ever have, and you kept me on my toes. Thank you, Rumpa. You're my biggest cheerleader at every sporting event, and I appreciate it more than you think. Dankeschön, Uma. You kept me updated on politics and showed me the true meaning of a survivor. We all know you're looking over us. And lastly, thank you to the administration. You set Carver apart from other schools through your constant dedication and involvement in school activities and treating every student as you would a coworker to make the transition into the working world less bumpy. High school was an uphill battle for certain, but one thing we could always count on was predictability. We would know or ask our followers, what day is it tomorrow? Which people would think to answer, Monday, obviously, but the students of Carver High knew we needed a numerical value, day 6. Morning announcements repeated every day, the Pledge of Allegiance, birthdays of kids who went to different schools ages ago, and Ms. Cabral's reminder to be respectful, be responsible, and be the best you can be. The choice is yours. Our class schedules, sports games, and lunch times were laid out for us. No matter what was happening at home, we knew the next day we'd be sitting in English class, period two. Unless, of course, there was a surprise attack from advisory or unannounced assembly that was sprung upon us. After college, we lose that sense of security. There's no telling what obstacle is waiting for us right around the corner. But no worries. Acceptance into college, landing a job, or deciding to enlist was half the battle. The most important thing to remember is, it is not how far you have to go. It is how far you have already come. Under your chair, you can find a card with your name on it. Inside, there is a piece of you that you should be proud of, or that others have recognized in you. Please take the time to read it and reflect on it. And if it's got mixed up and it's not your name, just pass it down the line. If you ever feel that you have a long road ahead of you and you're not sure how to trudge forward, please remember these victories you've already won. These accomplishments and qualities are what make you an individual, but together, it's what leaves a legacy. As a class, we speak German, Japanese, Spanish, French, and read Braille. We've become Dracula, skipped into the woods, and trekked Oklahoma. We walked in the shoes of police officers, nurses, veterinarians, teachers, and librarians through internships. We performed over 4,000 hours of community service, helping Carver's youth, the environment, and food pantries. Class of 2016, we've blazed our trail through Carver High School. When can their glory fade? Oh, the wild charge they made, all the world wondered. Honor the charge they made, honor the Carver Light Brigade, the Noble 100. Mr. Neef ended every speech with, "It is with pride I serve as your principal." So now it's my turn to say, "It is with pride that I have served as your classmate." Thank you.
Ms. Hanlon Kavicki is chairperson of the school committee for the town of Carver. Will you now join Mr. Souza for the awarding of the diplomas? Ms. Hanlon Kavicki, as the superintendent of the Carver Public Schools, I attest that the members of the class of 2016 who are before you have fulfilled all of the local and state requirements for graduation from this institution as stipulated by the school committee. I present to you the class of 2016, and we'll now proceed to call the roll as you, assisted by Mr. Souza, award the diplomas. Carly Marie Ryan. Ariana Nicole Rosen. Erin Elizabeth Alexander. Bridget Mary O'Connor. Jonah Philip Pushkar. Allison Kathleen Tugas. Alex David Bertoni. Connor Wood Blomquist. Ashley Elizabeth Bossy. Megan Rose Burnell. Avery Catherine Carrera. Megan Rose Colony. Nadia Patricia Goliabon. Mackenzie Lauren Gray. Kyle William Hanrahan. Evan James Hermano. Patrick Joseph Hurley. Katie Elizabeth Rodriguez. Justin Smith Schindler. Megan Caroline McCarthy. Emma Elizabeth Riley. Thomas Mark Sullivan. Gabrielle Suzanne Tracy. Mackenzie Lynn Aragol. Victoria Christine Bell. Mackenzie Nicole Bolando. Zachary Martin Benavides. Tessa Megan Berry. Liam Michael Borgeson. Allison Marie Brown. Michael Thomas Buckley. Vincent John Birdsick. Paul Edward Butts. Aubrey Lynn Kasha. Joseph Francis Carpenter III. Jared Michael Chadwick. Benjamin Alexander Cook. Dustin James Costa. Ryan Roland Crittenden. Jacob Daniel Cummings. Christian William Frades. John Mark Della Pascoli, Jr. Chelsea Ann Dion. Andrew Michael Dixon. Stephanie Marie Downing. Jessica Rose Evans. Nicholas Stewart Falzerano. Matthew McKenzie Ganshert. Salvatore William Gentili. Nicholas Christian Guerrier. Kristen Ann Gillum. Miranda Mabel Giorgio. Devin Peter Hallett. Courtney Noelle Hannon. Charles William Harris. Kyle Richard Harrison. Riley Joseph Kennedy. Jonathan Anthony Lanigan. Sarah Ann Malley. Natalie Elisa Marshall. Kirsten Bravender McCaig. Ryan Patrick McGinnis. Nicholas Michael Messina. Kelly Lynn Middendorf. Tess Olivia Moore. Kaylee Lynn Moran. Brianna Elizabeth Moscato. Joseph Achilles Moda. Crystal Elizabeth Neal. Mark Henry Nelson. Amani Damaris Nieves. Martin Joseph O'Connell Jr. McKenna Therese Patterson. Alan John Pearson. Tanisha Santos Pires. Jill Leanne Place. Meredith Brania Plant. Tyler James Ragazzini. Raven Nicole Rattano. Tiana Nase Rao. Joshua Edward Sanabria. Haley Marie Silva. Holly Regina Silva. Abigail Lee Simmons. Jonathan Emerson Spaulding. Matthew Owen Spooner. Christian Eric Sullivan. Alyssa Suzanne Turner. Michael Richard Vitale. Monica Ann Walsek. Sophia Bell Williams. Sean Gary Willis. Melanie Lynn Wright. Miss Aya Rosen, please come to the front of the stage and lead the class of 2016 in the symbolic act of moving their tassels. When the class of 2016 walks off this stage today, they will join us as contributing members of the Carver community. You will find the town of Carver even stronger with their presence. Faculty, staff, dignitaries, I now invite you to leave the auditorium and form your walkway to welcome the class of 2016. Thank you. we all acknowledge the class of 2016 as they leave this stage and walk on to the next.
I think I got 43 of them.